If you're thinking about relocating to London and don't know where to start, well then this video is definitely for you. My name is Ugo Arinze with Keller Williams and Onyx Property Team. I am a London-based property agent, property consultant. I especially like working with people looking to buy property in London or who are relocating to London. I've been in London for over 10 years now. I relocated from Washington, D.C. in the States. And initially when I was relocating, I rented and I've since bought. So definitely this is quite personal for me as well to put together these kind of videos to help ease the process and make sure that when people are either buying or relocating to London, they have all the information that they need. We're going to dive into this video and walk you through the key things that you need to know about the rental process if you're relocating and you want to start off with renting a flat or home in London. The first thing you're definitely going to have to consider if you're relocating to London is where you actually want to live. Now, London has some incredible neighborhoods in different areas. It's set up as boroughs. There's 32 boroughs covering Greater London. And so that gives you a lot of diversity as far as options. So if you want edgy and hip and cool, you might think of Angel or Camden. If you're in the finance sector and you want to be close to work, you can perhaps look to live close to what we call the city. Or we've got a second financial area called Canary Wharf and the Isle of Dogs and living out there. If you are in the legal profession and want to be close to where you work in the halls of justice, then perhaps Holborn might make more sense. If you are a French national and you want to be close to not just the schools, but theater and things that really are catering to the French community, then South Kensington has a very thriving French community. Or if you're American and you are coming over and your child might be attending the American School in London in St. John's Wood and you want to be close to that, then St. John's Wood is a wonderful neighborhood, but around there as well are pretty cool areas as well, whether that's Swiss Cottage or Maida Vale and others. So the key is starting with kind of where you want to live, but that's typically going to be a function of either where you're going to school or work, what type of commute you might want to have. So trying to get that clear is really important. That of course then becomes tempered with budget. You're gonna have to figure out how much you can afford to spend in for your rental situation, and it's going to have to cover not just the rent you pay but some other costs as well, which I'll talk about later. One of the first things definitely to point out is unless you're moving from New York or Tokyo or something like that, odds are you're going to find London much more expensive than where you're moving from. You could argue your rent here is going to be more than your mortgage if you've owned in the past. So you definitely need to understand, obviously, the cost of living in London. I've gotten, you know, done various videos on the cost of living in London. So make sure to check them out. And actually, I will make sure to ask you if you do like this video, if this is your first time watching one of my YouTube videos, please make sure to subscribe. I put out weekly videos talking about the property market in London, as well as life and culture and what makes this an incredible city. So I hope you'll stay tuned and be watching more of the videos as they come out every week. But coming back to budget, it's really important you get clear on that, because obviously that's going to balance out where it is you might want to live and also what it is you want to have for that budget. Do you need other amenities beyond just the housing? So is, you know, a secured building with a porter if you're, you say, traveling a lot internationally? That might be quite important to you. Obviously, we're still in the midst of COVID, so, you know, perhaps living in a more modern building where you get other amenities, whether that's gym or pool or a residence space. Some of them have additional lounge spaces where you can hang out, might be quite important. Obviously, now we've also put a real premium on outdoor space, whether that's balconies or gardens, those types of things. All of those things will impact your budget. Typically, if you're getting a two-bedroom flat in London and you want to be, say, in zone two, you know, you're going to probably need to be ready to prepare to pay anything from 1,500 pounds a month to 3,500 pounds a month. So that's, you know, quite a hefty budget. If you're looking for a home with three or four bedrooms, you're probably now talking well north of 5,000 pounds a month. The other thing about that budget is also a style of property you might want. Again, London is great for its architecture. We have a lot of older homes. Some and many have been renovated, but some might not have been. So, you know, one of the things that drives me crazy is the dual, you know, faucet taps. I don't like that. You might see that quite often. So again, depending on the level of modernness you want in a property, that might impact your budget as well. Then the other thing to point out for you is that, do you want a furnished or unfurnished flat? Now again, in many places, unfurnished is the only option. However, here in London, I have to say, I don't know exactly the statistic, but I gotta believe, given that we do a lot of rental properties, it's probably about 60-70% of properties, I would say, are actually available as furnished. The other thing, yeah, you need to consider is furnished or unfurnished. If you're, say, a student moving over, you might really like that you now don't have to worry about buying furniture, so that's really important for you. But perhaps if you're a family moving over and you've sold a property, or you really know that this is going to be a long-term move and your company's giving you a budget to move your furniture over, you then might want an unfurnished property. Some landlords are flexible, say they can offer it both as furnished or unfurnished, and some landlords will offer it as partly furnished. So maybe you get the key items such as your beds and a sofa, but then you have to fill in the rest. Next up to mention is if you're traveling with a pet. That is definitely where you're going to have a lot of restrictions. I'd say probably, you know, less than 50% of properties will make allow you to have pets. Obviously, that depends on what part of the city you're considering. And it's not even, in some situations, it's not even a matter of whether the landlord is okay with it, is that in their lease, they have prohibited it. And so I've got videos on the difference between leasehold and freeholds. You can check that out. But basically, if a property is in a building or say a converted house with other units, there's a governing lease that dictates what each owner can or cannot do. So that lease might prohibit pets, whether the landlord is okay with you having a pet or not. So once you've identified a property, the one thing you might not realize is that you can actually offer less than the asking rent. So that is something I wasn't used to in the States. Whatever the rent was basically what the rent was. But here it is typical for tenants to negotiate, especially if it's more of a tenant-friendly market. Certainly last year when we were deep into COVID and we lost all the international students and travelers and tourists, tenants were renegotiating and asking considerably less than the asking rent. Also, as part of making an offer, you can also put in different factors, whether it's obviously the start date, whether it's furnished or unfurnished, but we also have a feature called a break clause. So that means that, say, most of our leases are 12-month lease terms. However, you can ask for a break clause starting from month 6, and it's typical to give 2 months notice. So meaning starting from month 4, you could give a 2-month break clause saying that from month 6, you no longer want the property. Sometimes it is a one-time break clause, so you have it, you know, the opportunity to put that request in just once. But in some situations, it might be a rolling break clause, meaning starting from month 6 up to month 12, you could give a 2-month notice and leave. Obviously, that is great flexibility for tenants who say their job situation might be a bit precarious. If you think you might, you know, lose your job or your roommate situation or whatever, it gives you maximum flexibility. Now, if you do ask for that, just note that most landlords will then ask for it on their part, meaning that your situation could potentially be disrupted in less than those 12 months if the landlord, say, has a situation where they feel like they might be able to get more rent than they've gotten in the past, or that you know, they have a personal reason to take it back or whatever, or don't find you to be a good tenant. So that gives them that flexibility as well. Both points are negotiated, so again, just letting you know that those are the types of things you can potentially negotiate as part of making an offer. Next, we're going to talk about, once you have made that offer and it's agreed, then it's a matter of passing tenant referencing. Obviously, there's nothing new about that, except for agents and landlords typically use third-party tenant referencing firms that will, you know, basically be focused on verifying your identity as well as right to rent. Obviously, the UK has now left the EU, so through Brexit, so European citizens, which automatically had a right to live here just by virtue of showing their EU citizenship, that is no longer the case. So you have to formally demonstrate that you are qualified to live here in the EU. Also with tenant referencing, obviously one of the big things that they're going to be verifying is your income. And if you're moving over, there's really no way for them to do that. For some higher executive role positions, you know, some landlords will accept, or tenant references will accept, the fact that you're showing a work contract and obviously means, then that should be fine. But for most people, they won't be able to demonstrate that. And therefore, you're typically not going to be able to pass tenant referencing. The other issue with tenant referencing is in verifying address is that obviously the reason you're looking for a property is that you don't have a UK address. But in order to get a UK address, you typically need a bank account open. But you can't get a bank account if you don't have a UK address. So it's very circular, it's very frustrating for many people. So one of the bits of advice that I've seen come across some of the Facebook groups that I'm in for expats is to make sure to try to get one of these online bank accounts going pretty early on, so that at least you have a bank account, and see then if that helps qualify you, because really as part of that tenant referencing, you need that bank account, you need that address. So just a tip on that side. If you're not able to pass tenant referencing, most landlords will accept 6 months rent in advance. So this is something you definitely need to be prepared for. So if you are thinking you're going to be able to get away with paying monthly rent, initially, if you're not able to pass that tenant referencing coming over as an expat or immigrant, definitely be prepared to have 6 months rent in a bank account ready to pay a landlord to cover that risk that you were not able to pass tenant referencing. Once all of that is now in place, you then would obviously get the tenancy agreement to read. I highly encourage you to read it. For most tenancies, especially under a certain threshold, we use what's called an assured short hold tenancy, an AST. So that assures you that at least it's a fairly standard agreement that the government has sanctioned and approved. You know your rights, you know the landlord's rights, and nobody's really deviating too dramatically. Obviously, if there's been other negotiated terms, you add those as addendum to the agreement. But again, the framework of rights is protected. Here in the UK, a long-term let certainly guarantees you a minimum of 6 months to stay in the property, obviously without, you know, disruption and peace and quiet and everything else like that. Back in June of, I think, 2019, the government basically banned all other fees for tenants having to pay it. So at this point, as a tenant now, if any agent or landlord asks you to pay any additional fees, admin fees, inventory check-in fees, they should not be allowed to do that. So make sure you know that your rights and that you do not have to pay any additional fees outside of your monthly rent, as well as a security deposit, which is typically 5 weeks up to a certain rental value amount. And anything over that, I think they can take up to 6 weeks as security deposit. And with that security deposit, it should be held with a government approved tenant deposit scheme, such as deposit protection scheme, or you know, another one similar to that. So make sure you know where your money is and your security deposits being held, and there's a formal process of arbitration should at the end of the tenancy the landlord wants to deduct from your deposit and you don't agree with that. So with that, the way the landlord should do it is making sure that there's a formal inventory check-in report done by a third party showing the condition of the property, all the meter readings have been taken, and then you then get that report. It should be clearly documented, pictures are taken throughout, things are highlighted, whether that's chips, whether that's paint color, whether that's wear and tear, those types of things. And then that is compared, another report is done at the end of your tenancy that then compares that, and then the landlord or the lettings agent will determine how much of that was normal wear and tear and how much of that was more damage during your tenancy that they will then say you should be responsible for. So just make sure you know how that process works. So now that you're almost ready to take your property, make sure you know that there will be additional costs you will be expected to pay, and that is a tenant's responsibility. Trash collection or resources of a community center, whatever, lights staying on, all those things, the street lights, things like that. It is the cost that you have to pay directly to the council, but that is a tenant's responsibility, and it's something you're going to need to budget for. It's driven based on the size of the property and who's living in it, the number of occupants, but not really the number of occupants, but you can get a single person discount, say if you're living in the property just by yourself. Other expenses you need to budget for will include things like utilities, whether that's gas, electricity, water, broadband, what have you. And then finally, TV license. And TV license is a payment to the UK government. It covers the cost, I think, primarily of the BBC service, broadcasting service. And it's not something you can really get around. In the past, you know, people say, oh, I don't have a TV, I shouldn't have to pay it. But if you do have a computer, which let's be honest, where a lot of people do get their news and, you know, entertainment, you still have to pay that TV license. So that's pretty much covers the highlights of the tenant renting process here in the UK, particularly in London. If you have any questions about the video, please drop me a message or a note in the comment section below. If you did like this video, please make sure to hit it that thumbs up so we can let YouTube know that I'm putting out great content. And if you at some point you think you might want a direct service to actually help you, guide you throughout the whole relocating process, please do get in touch. I love working with clients from all over the world, helping them settle into London. I've done it for countless families, whether that's a young student looking for a studio or one bedroom flat to a family needing a 5-6 bedroom home. I've done the full range. So hopefully your journey into London is as smooth as possible. But if you've got any questions, I'd love to hear from you. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll check you out in the next video. Thanks so much for watching. Make sure to check out the other videos on my YouTube channel where I share great things about the London property market and living in this incredible city. So that's Ugo Arenze with Onyx Property Team and Keller Williams. Bye for now.